This is Ben Jordan, and you're listening to Live and in Color with Wolfie D.
Hey, this is Jimmy Street, host of the Live and in Color with Wolfie D podcast. Hear the life and times of professional wrestler Wolfie D, from his time in the territories with PG-13 to his time in WWE, ECW, WCW, TNA, and more. Nothing is off limits, and nothing will be held back. Thanks again for tuning in. Here he is, Wolfie D.
Welcome, welcome, welcome once again to Live in Color with Wolfie D and my man Jimmy across the street. Jimmy, I am still battling this daggum COVID and whatever it is now. I think it's done turned into just a sinus infection, but I'm still bad. I ain't been this sick. So, well, I ain't been sick like this for this long in forever.
I know, yeah.
I don't feel bad. I'm just sound like shit. I'm a snot factory.
Just so happens you have a weekly podcast that we do here. Whose idea was that? But no, I'm just kidding. But seriously, you have to sound good. I know, man, because I've thought about that. And, you know, I know, you know, I used to, you know, think about like people would get out of work for they couldn't talk. You know, I lost my voice. Like, what would we do? We would just have to sound like this, you know, but.
Yeah, I apologize if it annoys anyone.
No.
We've got to make it through it.
Yeah, no. But we got a great show today, man. Yeah,
I'm excited about this, man. I'm, you know, it puts things into perspective. I'm sitting here bitching about being sick for a week. And we got Ben coming on, who's, like you said, man, on the teaser that you put out. You know, he's in the fight of his life, man, straight up.
Yeah. And so, of course, any prayers, any positive vibes, any thoughts, any good just vibes, whatever, give them to Ben if you got one to give, you know, because that's he is in the fight of his life. And I was worried that that sounded a little too dramatic, but, you know, the conversation backs it up, you know, that's where what, you know, this coming up, I feel like I would say a good portion of our show will be talking about it. So I assume.
For sure. You know, and me and you went back and forth on whether we even wanted to ask him to do this or not.
Right.
Because of, you know, I just have this feeling that there's going to be some people, oh, they just did that just because, not because they're nice people. You know?
Right.
And we talked to Ben ourselves and, hey, if you don't want to do this. And then also on top of that, you know, his wife had made the Facebook page for him and all that. So they're okay with people knowing about it, and he's okay with talking about it. And by God, he's got the best attitude. I know I wouldn't have the attitude he's got.
Me too.
Yeah. Doing this, man, ain't no way. I'd be giving up probably. I'd be really giving up. But you know, this is just kind of a hey. We want everybody to, you know what's going on with him and. Maybe people that hadn't talked to him in a while, like myself, you know, hadn't seen him. And
right.
we talk every single day. And, you know, it's cool, you know?
Yeah, man.
But
we love Ben.
We just keep sending those positive vibes, praying, whatever it is you do, because, you know, he needs them.
Yeah, he's fighting this. And like, you know, like we say, you know, we love Ben, you know, and, you know, we just want to celebrate Ben and, you know, and that's the importance of this show, you know.
Let everybody know how much, let him know how much everybody loves him, man.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, let's not waste any time then, brother.
No, let's get on it, man. I ain't got a lot of voice.
I know. we gotta keep that fresh. Well, cool, man. Well, I tell you what, then we'll be right back after these messages with our buddy Ben Jordan.
Hey folks, to get your official Live and in Color with Wolfie D merchandise, go to prowrestlingtees.com/livewolfied. Check it out.
If you're listening to Live and in Color with Wolfie D on Apple Podcast and like what you're hearing, go ahead and leave a 5-star rating. And while you're at it, write a review. Tell us what you liked. Tell us what you'd like to hear in the future. It's very important to us and always appreciated. Thanks again.
All right, folks, we're back. And once again, you survived. You survived the break, and we are back with a very, very, very special episode today This one, man, I'm just going to say it, man. I love you, Ben Jordan, and I'm introducing you right now. That easily, that simply, a lot of people know what's going on with you, and I want you to come on here, and I want you to say what you got to say, man, and thank you for coming on.
Well, I just want to say I appreciate you having me on. It's great to be here. I love you, too. I love Jimmy, and ain't many people at this day and time that I don't love. I love everybody.
Love you too, buddy. Yeah.
You know, yes, it's so crazy because I don't know what, 4 weeks ago, I got a message from Jimmy that said, hey, Ben wants to call you and talk about your hip surgery. And then you call me and you're like, hey, man, what's that entail? And blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, man, it's brutal. It's the worst thing I've ever went through. Blah, 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 blah. And then the very next week, you're telling me that you've got, terminal cancer, bro. And I'm like, what the, you know, this is crazy. I can't believe this.
Yeah. What nice was the news I wanted to hear. Which, you know, we say terminal, they got a lot of good treatments. We're going to go at it. We're going to fight this thing hard.
I know you will.
Yeah. Any extra time I can get with my family and my friends, I'm gonna fight for every minute I can get on this earth.
Yeah,
I'm gonna go at it hard.
I believe you, man. Yeah,
yeah. And you've always been hard, man. I told you this, man, off the air, but I'm gonna say it right here. I mean, I have a very fond memory of being a kid. Still a mark, ready to get in the business. And it was a WWE show at the Municipal Auditorium. And I think I'm pretty sure you worked that night. And me and my buddy were sitting in the crowd, and it was after the show or whatever. And you were out there and just mingling with the fans, talking to the fans. I was like, I elbowed my buddy, hey, that's Ben Jordan. So it ain't like I didn't know who you were before I got in the business. And I think that's pretty cool. Yeah.
that's awesome. Pretty cool.
Just to thank somebody that I ended up in the business with, and then somebody like you that's, you know, come in, blew everybody away, you know, you had your run on. And to think at one time you were looking at me like, hey, look at that guy. He's a wrestler, you know.
Yeah. I absolutely was, man. I was like, man, I told my buddy, I remember. I mean, I could see it. I could see. I think you had on, I want to say like purple. I mean, I could see you right now. I could see you and standing there talking to people. And me and him were up a few rows, and I was elbowing. I was like, hey, man, that's Ben Jordan. You know, Ben Jordan on Memphis. Yeah, that's how much I loved Memphis and watched the people that were on it. And you were there before me. And, hell, I watched you in Global and all that stuff. So, man, you were something to me before I ever made anything of me.
I appreciate that, Whoopi. You know, makes me feel good that there was anybody even, you know, looking or caring, you know, so.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. So you called me, and then a week later, you had heart pains or something.
Yeah, I was having chest pains. I thought I was having a heart attack. And, of course, if I was having a heart attack, I'd have probably died because we left Shelbyville that we'd been at my grandson's ball tournament and thought about waking the wife up in the middle of the night because my chest was hurting. But I let her sleep. And then the next day, we had our little dog with us, and she's like, I'm taking you straight to Centennial Hospital. And I say, it's okay. Let's take the dog home first. So we take the dog home. When we get home, then it's like, well, let's go ahead and unpack the car. So if I'd have been having a true heart attack, I'd have probably already fell over. But so then we could get to the hospital, and they throw the EKG on me and everything. And they're like, well, you know, you're not having a heart attack. And they just kept testing and they'd seen something in my lung, and they said, it's probably pneumonia in your chest. You probably got like an infection between your ligaments and your bone, and we knocked that out.
Did you have a cough or anything?
No, but now a month ago, I was trying to cough, and when I tried to cough, my ribs would hurt. It would hurt so bad that I couldn't get a good cough. I couldn't cough good.
Yeah.
And so for about a month, I've been complaining with my side hurting, with my ribs hurting. And I thought, man, if I don't cough so hard, I don't crack the rib, you know, you get old like me, stuff like that can happen. So now we find out that I got cancer and it's in my bones, and they're like, yeah, there's a spot on your rib right there. That's why that's hurting. So that explains all of the pain in my ribs.
That is so crazy to me. And I mean, the craziest part is that it's gotten this far along and you didn't notice anything beforehand?
Nope. Sure didn't. You know, I had my knee replacement in December, but you know, the only x-rays we did and of the knee and all of the images, all of that was from like the waist down.
Right.
And so, you know, nothing ever picked up. I went back sometime in May, I think it was April, May, and I thought I was getting, you know, getting the flu or something. And I went, and they listened to me, and they said, well, you don't sound too bad. We're going to just go ahead and give you a steroid shot. So I took the steroid shots, and that cleared me up, you know, pretty much. So maybe at that time, if I was coughing real bad or something, maybe they'd have done an x-ray, we may have could have seen it then. I don't know.
That is absolutely insane, man. It really is, man. I can't imagine, God, as a person, as a husband, dad, whatever, man, when the doctor comes in and tells you that. I mean, did your heart not just drop into your stomach?
It did. The lady, she wasn't about 5'3", something like that. But, you know, she came in with her little white coat. And she told me she had good news that my heart was good. I'm like, yes. And then she grew about 4 or 5 more feet tall. And she put the black on. And you know, she said, but you've got cancer. And I'm like, cancer? That's just out of left field for me. I was like, what?
I can't imagine the feeling.
So we took it from there. You know, it's like, okay, we had to start getting tested. And I failed every test they gave me. So I was like, yeah, three fears. And I was about ready after enough tests, and they kept saying, you know, I had cancer here and there and the other. I was like, well, let's get out of here before they tell me I got it in my big toe.
Jeez.
So, you know, let's get out of here. But at the time, you know, Wolfie, I thought about it. You know, I had that one thing to say, like, no, not me, not me, not me. But then I thought about it. It's like, you know, at this point, there's nothing I can do. It's in God's hands. It's God's will. And, you know, I'm not gonna fight with that. I'll go with his plan. He created the universe.
Yeah.
And so he knows the plans better than anybody. And so this is his plan for me, and that's the way I'm gonna go with it.
Yeah, man. I tell you what, man. I've been super impressed with your attitude about the whole thing. I mean, honestly, I don't know how I would be in that situation. I probably do know how, and it wouldn't be anything like you're doing. In this situation, I'm probably a lesser man than you are, Ben.
Well, you know, like I said, I've watched several people close to me have the same diagnosis. I've got a brother-in-law that's got cancer, and he's going through treatments. And my wife's cousin, her husband, he passed away about a year ago from cancer. And I watched him go through it, and plus my brother-in-law, and watching them, I'm going, how do they handle this? Well, how are they doing this so good? And then when it hit me, I said, look, I'm joining the team, brother. And you ain't getting me down.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You know? So they are inspirations to me because of the way they had it. So,
yeah.
And the way my brother-in-law's dealing with it.
Well, you're an inspiration, man. Just honestly, I mean, let's be honest here. Me and you haven't talked in, you know, a long time, and now we talk every day. And me and you made that promise, and I appreciate that because you're helping me more than you know. But so for the listeners, the treatment, okay, so you got fitted for a mask today, and you know, let's tell them what's going on here.
Yeah, well, the mask is so that they can give me radiation treatment to my brain to treat the spots on my brain, and we're going to do that We're going to hit that first with the radiation, and then as soon as we get done with that, then we go back over to the regular oncologist, and we're going to start on the chemotherapy treatments. And they got they told me they had different kinds. I had to do some more blood work so they can kind of pinpoint each kind of cancer and go from there. You know, they'll make a plan to treat each place. I've got it.
Yeah. Man, I don't know, Jimmy. I'm at a loss right this second, man.
Man, I mean, I'll say this, you know, every day since I found out about it, I've been in a weird state of depression. And sometimes, Ben, I don't want to ever put that on you, because I know right now you've got this hope, and I want you to have that hope, because that's what's going to get you through this. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, and your faith and hope. And so sometimes I'm like, man, I don't want to be all like, brother, man, love you, brother, man. You know, like, I do love you, man. You know that. And I text you that all the time. But sometimes I'm like, man, am I bringing him down by making him think of it, you know? And you know, because I know sometimes when I was going through some stuff in my life, and none of it has been this, I'm not even going to compare it, but you know, everybody has a few hard times, and I was always like, man, you know, I want people to contact me because it makes me feel like they are supporting me. So it's yeah, like, I know it's good to contact you, but it's also, man, am I reminding them of something? Because, you know, I don't know, man, but you know, I just, go ahead.
I'm going to tell you, Jimmy, I'm going to tell you, since the news, and we didn't throw everything out there immediately, because you know we had to kind of swallow the pill. We had to say, okay, this is what we got, and then you know, as people would find out, everybody would, you know, people would contact, and it grew and grew. Then we finally, my wife put out what was going on, did a Facebook thing, and I knew this. Then we were just getting flooded, right. And I didn't know that many people out there even knew me, and boy, I'm getting people reaching out from everywhere, and it is great, you know. And like I said, I'm getting so many prayers, and you know, I kind of make a little joke of it, but just to stay lighthearted about it, I'm like, I'm getting so many prayers, my feet's coming off the ground. So, and awesome. I'll take everyone I get. I come home from work. I come home from the doctor, let's say, and there's three cards in the mail from people that I knew. One's a girl I went to school with, grew up right down the street from me. I hadn't talked to her in 30 years. She sends me a card, and yeah, I'm like, wow, you know. But like I said, I don't know if I can just, whatever I've got left in life to do, whatever the good Lord, you know, if there's something in me, some kind of message is supposed to come out, you know, I'm all in, you know.
Yeah. Golly, man, like I said, you've got such hope and such faith, and I know so many people are praying for you, man. You know, we know you can lick this, brother. But I would love to, you know, you were kind of telling us about the mask before. Can you go into a little bit about?
Yeah, you know, I get there and I have to lay basically on the same type bed. It's hard. That they're going to treat me, that I'm going to be laying on to be treated. And they're like, this will be the exact, it'll probably be in a different room, but it'd be just like this. But I'd lay on there. They fitted me for some kind of a body cast for when they radiate my ribs. But they added that because they said, if that spot's bothering you, we'll go ahead and hit that too. And I said, yeah. And matter of fact, that's really the main place I'm hurting. But, really? Yeah. But then the whole deal of going today was to get fitted for a mask so that they could do the radiation treatment on my brain. And so they get, it's kind of like a plastic, rubbery plastic, and it's like a mesh type deal, and it's really, really hot. It's not hot enough to burn the skin, but similar to if you go to a barber and they do the hot towel on your neck.
Okay.
Similar to that.
Yeah.
And they put this against your face and your head, and then they strap it down to the back, to the table, and it's pulling on you. It's a little bit of pressure. They're pushing in because they want to get it to where it'll fit really good. And yeah, this has to stay on you for 15 minutes.
Mm.
And they said, well, you know, fitting for the mask will be similar to how the treatment will be. So you go in there for about 15 minutes for the duration of however many days I end up going. So,
well, It's going to go good, man. I know it is.
It is, yeah.
And I put a thing out on my Facebook today. I'm gonna change direction here real quick. If anybody had any questions for you and stuff like that. And believe me, you know I texted you earlier that a friend of mine, Scott, he's a longtime fan. He was a photographer, and he had a picture of you, and he's like, hey, man, can you hook me up with Ben, man? I'd like to send him a picture that I found of him that I took him at the gardens and yada, yada. We're going to get that done. Me and you talked about that. But so many people have been reaching out. And so, all right, I'm going to go with this one first. Tim Fox on Facebook wants to know, what is Ben's favorite? He's got two questions, so this is a two-parter.
Okay.
What is Ben's favorite match of his career?
That's a hard one.
I know. I hate that one, too.
Y'all get this answer all the time on the podcast. It's like there's too many to name.
Yeah.
You know, I could name, you know, I got to wrestle some of the greats, you know, like Jerry Lawler, you know, Legion of Doom. All kind of, that's good just for like the highlight reel, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
But, yeah.
But like my global days were really good. That's when I really got to do some things on my own to where I wasn't just going out there doing what they called and
right.
That's it.
Right.
I got to have some offense, you know, and
right.
had a great match with Jerry Lynn.
Yeah.
On there. We had a really good match. And one
you
of
can't have favorite, a good match with Jerry Lynn.
For real. I was just there. Really, it was fun. And they gave us a long time for a TV match. And so about halfway through, I believe we were both blowed up. But anyway, another one of my favorite went down in global was with Lightning Kid, Sean Waltman.
Yeah.
And his Lightning Kid. And we had a match. I had actually some of the boys calling me watching, you know, they was watching on ESPN, and they're like, are you about to win this match? Are they putting the light heavyweight strap on you? And unfortunately, they didn't. But, yeah, that was a really good match. And
so those are the ones that stick out to you, Jerry Lynn and
yeah. You know, and we just talked to him the other day. Which I was green in the business, so I wasn't going to get a whole lot, but Tony Anthony really took care of me.
Yeah.
And when I was green, he really, it taught me a lot to get in there with him. He didn't just wipe the floor with me, but he would let me do some things. And then of course he'd get his stuff. But just him, working with me the way he did really taught me a lot in the early TV days, like in Memphis.
Right. You know? So, all right. So the other part of this question is, and this, I mean, doesn't have to involve you. I think the way they're asking this is it doesn't, but what's your favorite match of all time?
And you got me again. You know, it's one of them. There's so many. I know I can't leave out, you know, my partner, Steve, me and Steve and the Wild Boys, because that's what I really turned into. Went from Ben Jordan to being Wild Boy Ben Jordan, and that became my thing. And the matches we had with the great Mephisto and Dante would have to
be
the
absolutely.
Best ever, because that was when we were in our, what you would call a prime. I wish something like that angle would have been the Memphis angle. I mean, if we could have got that shot with the, you know, back when the crowds were still there.
Yeah.
Go around the loop. If we had that match we were doing in Columbia and Nashville and places like that, I think it would have got over if you'd have got the right push, you know,
I think it would have sold tickets anywhere. Yeah.
Back when we were in our prime like that with the Devils. So.
Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. So, all right. So take yourself out of it and just, what's your favorite match you've ever seen?
Favorite match I've ever seen. I'll tell you, you know, you get a lot of the old stuff from Lawler Dundee.
Yeah.
I'd have to put them in there. Of course, you know, when I was in the Marine Corps, we were all big Ric Flair fans.
Yeah.
You know, we liked his stuff. Actually, pinpointing a single match, I don't think I can do it. I know there's so many good teams. And the one thing that I hate is when I was overseas was when the Fabulous One phenomenon happened. And I missed it. I was going to wrestling and I couldn't see anything because I was in Japan, and I missed the whole fabulous. And then I come back and watch the tapes of the stuff, and I was like, how did I miss going to this?
Yeah, that shit was awesome. That shit was awesome. But I'll tell you my favorite match, and it's one of the, you know, a lot of people say it. It actually kind of changed the business and a lot of people's opinions. This is so cliche almost, but I'm a huge Randy Savage mark, and him and Steamboat at WrestleMania 3 was probably one of the best matches I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
And you know the story behind that is Randy, you know, laid it out, wrote it out, gave it to Ricky. And I just talked to Ricky on a show that me and him were doing an autograph sign. I talked to him about it, and it was definitely, and it's so crazy to me to think that back in that time that Randy Savage would have, you know, written out this match, and they called each other, hey, what's spot two? What's spot? I mean, come on, man. I've never done that.
Yeah, I can't do it. It's too hard for me to remember.
Yeah. But, I mean, honestly, one of the best matches ever, and it did change the way that wrestling went along in the ring. You know, it did.
Yeah.
For sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
Jimmy, you can go ahead. I've got some more questions.
Well, actually, you know what's funny is I'm going to a listener question, too. And this one is from all of our good buddy, Mr. Quentin Charisma. You know, he's forgotten more about Middle Tennessee wrestling than we remember. So we're gonna see what he's got to ask Mr. Ben. So it's actually a two-parter. So Quentin asks, he says, here's a couple off the top of my head. 1993 Wild Boys versus Devils. Anything goes street fight at Woodbine Community Center. They brought a car bumper to the ring. Whose bumper and whose idea was it to use it?
Okay. I remember that night. They you know, wanted us to bring weapons or something. We didn't have anything. Now, we did grab the garbage can that everybody was throwing their nachos and their spit and their cokes. And, you know, so we grabbed that on the way, too. But we went out back, and there was an old truck bumper there, and Steve grabbed it and picked it up. Brought it on in, and we had nothing else. So, like I said, as we come by the garbage can, we're like, well, let's take this too. We just throw it all in. It was bad. There was like a glass Coke bottle, you know, in the garbage can. It was all kinds of stuff, and you know, it's pretty nasty. And I love Quentin. He knows way more about this wrestling thing than I ever even dreamed
of. I know. He's a savant, man. Well, he's got one more if you're game for it.
Yes, throw it at me.
Okay, so he says this one Ben might not remember, but it was a really funny deal. So it was because Ben didn't get hurt. It was funny because you didn't get hurt. But in 96 in Petersburg, Tennessee, the Wild Boys versus the Devils, I think you see a pattern here. The dressing rooms were on opposite sides at the top of a stage. The Wild Boys were chasing the Devils back. The Devils make it into the dressing room. All of a sudden, Ben slips and falls and slides all the way into the heel dressing room. From what I can remember, Ben got up and him and Tommy started fighting back out of the door on the stage, and Tommy got back away and back in the dressing room. It was one of those things that you didn't think you'd see, and Ben sliding like he was sliding into second base. Do you remember that?
That I don't remember. I remember being in the dressing room, and I'm like, we're fighting in the dressing room, but nobody is really seeing me. Why am I fighting in the dressing room? Because nobody can see that. But I don't remember that I slid in there.
Okay.
I remember fighting in that building.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. Well, that, you know, Quentin really doesn't forget stuff, so maybe did, maybe you didn't. I don't know. We'll say that, but
I just don't remember the slide. I don't remember the slide.
Yeah. Well, talk about the match with Jerry Lawler and on USWA TV. Talk about the build up to that and the promo.
I've wrestled him more than once on TV down there. Seemed like when just there was nobody else to beat up. It's like, all right, Ben, I'm with you today. But you're talking about the where he beat me up so bad that Chris Champion had to come out to save me, and then we both get beat up.
Right.
That's the match. Well, prior to that match, Lawler and Jimmy Valiant were going, you're going to have a match or something coming up like this. Anyway, it's supposed to be Lawler's birthday. And Kerry Von Erich was there that day. And they had a, they had, the deal was they had a garbage can. They wrapped it up. And they had it water in it where Kerry's going to go out and give Jerry Lawler the present from Jimmy Valiant and, you know, throw the water on. Well, funny thing is, Kerry's, you know, he wanted to pull a rib. So he goes down to the local gas station. Then this is like in January, December, January, February, somewhere. It's middle of winter. And so he goes down to the gas station and gets two bags of ice. And he ices the water down.
Oh, man.
He wanted to make sure it was getting cold when he threw it on Lawler. So he does. He goes out there and says, you know, this is from Uncle Jimmy. Happy birthday. And he throws his fast. Of course, Lawler gets up mad. They do the deal where he calls. Dave Brown calls Jimmy Valiant, and they're talking on the phone, whatever. And then supposedly Valiant hangs up on him, and Lawler's pissed off. Well, the next thing that happens is I'm standing in the ring, you know, and I'm Lawler's match after that, and he's human. So he goes off, and he pretty much kills me. And then, you know, I take the bump over the desk and everything, and at that point, after I took the bump over the desk, I just laid there. I was like, okay. You know, spotlight off me. Let's get over on Chris. Because I think they were going into an angle.
Gotcha. Okay. That makes sense. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to read a couple more things here. Donnie Davis on Facebook. Ben, no question here. Just want to thank you for all your contributions to the business of pro wrestling and to this podcast. And my prayers are with you. Jimmy Devine says on Facebook, I was a young man in the wrestling business and got to work Ben Jordan. He taught me how to make a wrestling match work. We were trying to come up with a finish, and I mentioned a spot, and he loved it. He also told me to take something from my match and correct it for the next time. So good advice from Ben there. And then Bobby Murray on Facebook says, were there ever any plans to elevate Ben on the Memphis roster?
Were there ever any plans to elevate me on the roster?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I went in there. I had a good spot. I was getting to do, you know, do the loop, do the whole territory. Money was good for me because I was living at home and I had a job.
Right.
And so it was just extra money, and I was having fun. And I got booked on all Eddie Marlin, all the spot shows. The only spot shows that didn't pay good was when we went for Buddy Wayne down
there. Buddy Wayne.
Down in either
Jimmy
Arkansas,
knows that story.
Oh, yeah.
Arkansas,
I've told Jimmy so many of those Buddy Wayne shows, yeah. Lord of mercy.
Yeah. So, yeah, I got to do all that. So, but then when it, I was watching younger guys, I was watching like the Scott brothers, Billy and Gary Scott come in. They come in about a year after I did, and they were going to these independent shows.
Yeah.
And they'd been coming up and they were on top of the Devils. Here I am. I'm still the first match putting people over, USWA, and they kept on, you know, and when nobody else would, when they needed it, somebody, and they didn't have any book, Eddie Marlin would call me at the last minute and say, hey, can you make fairgrounds? Can you do this? I was their go-to guy when they didn't have anybody.
Yeah.
And I was getting bookings with some independents, and then Eddie would call me and say, hey, can you do fairgrounds? And I'm like, well, I told Freddie Morton I was going to be in Columbia. Well, I would call Freddie and say, hey, I got to do the USWA. Eddie called. And finally, I was like, you know, Eddie called that one night, and I said, well, Eddie, I'm already booked. I'm sorry. And, you know, it went on from there, which it just didn't seem like, in a way, I was good at my spot.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if, you know, that hurt me or what, because I never bucked the system or argued with them on what they were doing with me, which they would put me over time from time to time and let me have some good spots. But I didn't feel like there was a place to go there.
Yeah. I mean, it's like sometimes you want to choose left instead of you choosing right, and you look back and you're like, yeah, should I have, you know, but yeah, you never
know. And I was always loyal, and they treated me really good. You know, I would get to ride to all the towns with Eddie and Bill because they knew I worked. So they're like, you ride with us, you can sleep, you know, on the way back. That way, you know, you get a little bit of sleep, which I didn't ever sleep. I was listening to their stories.
Let's take a quick time out and get a word from one of my dope-ass sponsors, and we'll be right back with more Live and in Color with Wolfie D. Hey folks, this is Wolfie D here, and if you are looking to buy or sell a home in Tennessee or Southern Kentucky, you're going to want to call my buddy, the rock star realtor, Benji Bowie. And you say, Wolfie, how do I get in touch with this rock star? Well, you can call him directly at 615-390-8216. You can go to his website, BowieHomes.com, that's B-U-I-E, homes.com, or you can email him at BenBowie34@gmail.com. When you need a home, you need the Rockstar Realtor.
Benji is a member of Exit Realty's Garden Gate team in Gallatin, Tennessee.
I want to know, like, because Bill trained you, right? We talked about this on the first show.
Yeah, the Bill training him. Yeah, we did.
And what was how was Bill training you? Like, how was that? How did it go?
Well, we started out. We were going to train in the little building up in Gallatin, where he had to have the all the beer stored in there. And of course that rings. And I think, Sonny Street explained it on Jimmy's show. You know, that was one of the hardest things ever. Well, the first day I go to train, Bill calls and says, we're going to Franklin, Kentucky. So we're moving the building to Franklin, Kentucky. So we get up there and the first building they had it in was a kind of a garage. It wasn't the casket company. Okay. It was another building for the first day. And of course, when I get there, Bill shows up, and then you got the Silver Fox, you know, Bruce Swayze shows up in this, you know, boy, he, you know, he always looked like $1 million. And he probably had it in his pocket too. But and Mike Porter shows up on my first day, you know, and so all these people, and then they're watching, you know, they show me a hip toss and this, that, and the other, and stuff like that, and they're like, you're going to be good. You're getting it, you know. But now training with Bill, you know, Bill really, in the beginning and through the training, he was really strict on just getting the technique down, you know, how to take bump, how to do the armory. Of course, you know, we start all of that with the, you know, doing your forward rows.
Did he teach you how to roll, like, you know, his bump, the back roll?
Yeah. No, he didn't teach me that one. No. Hey, I bet if he would have and if I'd have done that, my back wouldn't have hurt as bad as it has.
God love him.
Oh yeah. I just spoke to him the other night.
Oh, did really? You? Awesome.
Yeah. I'm glad that happened.
Yeah, and I mean, I know he might have a little bit going on. He knew who he was talking to, and. Yeah. You know, I thanked him for all the stuff he did for me and told him I loved him, you know, and everything. And he sounded really good, and he was really, you know, really happy and just glad to talk.
That's awesome. Yeah. I'm glad that took place, man.
That is.
I'm also glad about the Downtown Bruno conversation that you're able to have and the Dirty White Boy conversation.
Man, Wolfie, you hooked me up on those because those are people that I was in the business with, but, you know, I don't got anybody's phone number, and I don't call nobody or talk to anybody. Usually when I got mostly out of the business, I'm like, well, I've got this life. And, you know, I didn't live my gimmick pretty much. I'm just me. And then when I leave wrestling, I go do my own home life, you know, just a regular guy, you know, and people will come up and they'll say, hey, I heard you wrestling on and I want to hear the stories and all. And you tell them, but then I just talk back to just normal life, you know?
Yeah. You text me something the other day that you were like, Jimmy, you know, I kind of feel cheated. I didn't follow my wrestling dream. And that really broke my heart. But, you know, I kind of sent back. I said, man, you weren't doing it for you. You were doing it for your family, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And, yeah. I mean, I could have dropped everything, dropped my job and all. And I could have really, but, you know, I'm 5'7". And when back in the early 90s, you know, we were like in the land of the giants.
Right.
I mean, I walk around the WWF arena, and I'm just walking around looking up at all these huge people. I felt like a little, you know, I felt like they were actual giants.
Yeah. It's understandable, yeah. though, because they were. Yeah. Most of them were, so, you know.
Oh, yeah. They were all huge and, you know, just all pumped up. But that's what I mean. For me to drop everything, to have the idea that I'm going to make it big, which sometimes that's what it takes.
Yeah.
You've got to go all in. And me, and Bill gave me some good advice. He told me one time, he said, all right, kid, he said, you got a good job. He said, you do this on the side and you keep your job. He said, and if this ever takes off, you'll know it. And then you can leave the job. But until it does, you keep that job. You got a pension coming, you know.
Yeah.
So that was some, and I think in 20, so I don't know how it's probably, it's been when TJ was still running. Before he passed, he was at a Saul show, and I seen him, and I guess I'd been in the business 20 years at that time, but I had my job, and I was getting closer to, you know, where I could retire if I wanted, and I just thanked him for the advice.
Yeah, Jimmy, that leads us into that big question.
Yeah, take it, Wolf.
Yeah, Ben, so me and Jimmy talked about this earlier, and we knew we were going to ask you this, and you just segued us. What is the worst? You just said the best. What's the worst advice you were ever given in the wrestling business?
The worst advice?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't really think I've had any. If it was real bad advice, I just didn't take it or just didn't listen to it. I'll give you one. Going to Global. Now I forgot to say the ones, because when I got the light heavyweight belt put on was with Horowitz. We had a good little series of matches, and if you ever wrestled Barry, you know he is all into the technical and this and the other, and he cares about every single move that's made.
Yeah.
And if you mess the move up, he'd let you know. But anyway, we were on our way to Dallas one time. Now, I don't usually say anything bad about people, and not really meaning to say anything bad. But yeah. At one point, we were riding with Tom Burton, which was Tom Davis at the time.
Yeah.
And it was Barry. Now, I'm not sure if we had a fourth person in the car with us or not, but they were kind of saying it was more Tom than anything. They're saying you're going to do this and you're going to do that and you're going to do the other, and I just looked at them and I said like this. I said you guys got to have this job. I don't. I said I've got a real job. I said so I'm not going to do none of it what you just said. I'm going to go down here and do whatever I do, and if I don't like it, I don't got to come. I said y'all got to come. I don't. So, that was all that. And no really hard feelings or nothing with that. It was just they were senior to me, and I understood they were trying to give me advice, but it's kind of like, you know, you're green, you got to do this, that, yeah. And I'm like,
well, I'll say it for you. Tom was a dick, and also Barry is the you know, me and Jimmy have been doing this show for 3 years now, Jimmy, almost.
Yeah, three. We're right at it.
And
yeah.
You know, Barry Horowitz tried to charge me to come here.
Ben knows.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and me and Barry reconnected after several years, and he usually calls me just about every Sunday. I haven't talked to him in a little while.
Mm-hmm. Well, you tell him I ain't giving him no money, and
he knows.
And to kiss my ass, by the way.
me and Barry reconnected. I'm glad we did. We talk. We have a good time. And me, you know, I love everybody.
Yeah.
And I'm going to get along with everybody, you know, the best I can. And I just, you know, like I said, I don't have bad words to say about anybody.
No,
I hear you. And that wasn't my point. It was just kind of a dig at Barry, and you let him know I said that. I just got buried by Sid Vicious on K&S WrestleFest. They mentioned my name, and he buried me.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Whatever. I don't do nothing bad to nobody, but whatever. Yeah. He might have me confused with Jamie. I don't know.
Oh,
maybe.
Man.
Maybe. That's happened a few or more times.
Yeah, so, two or more times.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you something that might work into some of this. So what is some advice? You know, Bill's given you great advice. You maybe received some bad advice. What is some advice that the current Ben would tell the younger Ben?
Oh, yeah, that's a good one. I should have got a little more serious about it, and should have gave it a little more effort, because at a certain point, I threw my hands up like, okay, I'm just going independence and the heck with, you know. I remember when it come to the point, I remember the point now. USWA, Steve Dahl had left. They put me in with Rex King, which me and him look nothing alike, and it's hard to make me a rocker, you know. But they had us in there working the Dirty White Boys, and I thought, hey, I'm getting my spot now. I'm getting a spot, you know. I like it. Picked up the bookings, you know. They're putting these guys over, so I'm getting in good. And then all of a sudden, I get the news they pulled me out. They brought another guy in. I'm really don't want to say his name because he's passed on. But I mean, that kind of hurt my feelings a little bit. I was like, well, I was here. Why did you have to bring this other guy in?
Yeah.
I'm already here.
Right. So right.
Then that hurt my feelings. And at that point, that's when I started getting the thing of, okay. Okay. So after that, then like with me and Steve, we'd done it and we was wanting to get somewhere. And then finally, and I'm going to tell you, George Weingroth gave us the best advice on it. He's like, you know, he told us the Randy Savage story. And he's like, you guys, you know, if you stay in the gym, eat right, everything, he's like, you'd be surprised where you go. Well, me and Steve, we had reached a rebellious stage at this point. And then we just, you know, heck with it. We didn't worry about staying in shape. And you could tell we were starting to just slide from there, you know. And so, Ooh. Yeah.
Gotcha. Yeah.
All right. I guess here's another kind of fun one. Pet peeves. What are some of your wrestling pet peeves? What shit can you not stand to see?
Well, probably the guys in the back going over the match. Yeah. I think that's the worst thing. You're sitting here, and me and Steve are usually sitting there, you know, beside each other. Back in the day, you know, you could smoke in the building. Steve would be smoking a cigarette. And these two kids be over. They're going through 50 million spots. It's like, I mean, we're just looking like, that is crazy. And it's like, you tell me all that, I'm not going to remember it. So just tell me out there. And then sometimes I'll be out there and I go, hey, Steve, you remember what the finish was going to be? I done forgot. We're doing the drop kick out of the corner. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So, all right, let's think here. Here's a good one for you. All right. So, I guess you had a match. Mule Day, did you wrestle Mule Day?
Yeah, he wrestled at the Mule Town Mania man battle royal or whatever. I'm just kidding.
56-man battle royal or whatever it was. So, Ben Jordan has one more match on any card, any house. I mean, whatever you want it to be. Who would you wrestle?
Ooh, that's a good one. That's a real good one. Seems how I've never planned on wrestling again, and we got an upcoming show Saturday.
You're wrestling on Saturday?
It's to help out with Rod Big.
Hot Rod,
you're wrestling.
Yeah, to benefit for Hot Rod's
family. Hold on a second. You're wrestling.
Well, now here's the secret, Wolfie, and don't tell nobody. I'm not doing that.
Well, they're all listening, Ben. And this won't air till Monday. So if you're wrestling Saturday, okay.
If they go Saturday, they'll find out that I was standing up there on the side of the apron. So,
Lord.
I try to tell family and everybody, don't come to this to watch me wrestle because I'm not doing nothing.
Yeah.
If they won't be there. They won't be in the match, you know, which I agreed to doing this before, you know, I got diagnosed. But I'm like, I can see, I feel fine besides a few hurting ribs. But, I'll be able to go do the same thing I was going to do. Nothing. So, but I mean, I don't want to hurt the wrestling business. And that's what I try to tell people when they want to book. I'm not able to do anything. I'll go and be there. But, you know, and you couldn't do this every week. you couldn't go because everybody would be going, come see him every week, and he just stands there. So, yeah, you might pull it off one time, but you know, you can't. And I'm just doing it because, you know, to try to contribute and to help.
Right.
But my ability is not there. And I don't like to, if I was seriously like, yeah, I'm going to do this match and get in there and make it look bad, there's no way I would do that.
Yeah. And Ben, I'm going to say this. I'm going to say this, man. As a athlete, competitor, blah, 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 you'll get on that apron and those people and that adrenaline will get going and you're going to want to do more than what you're saying right now.
Well, we did that. We did that last time. Me and Steve, we weren't going to do much. And then we got in there and we got going. Of course, I apologize on the podcast earlier that day to all the devils that from giving them the old Idaho. I'm bad about spudding people. And so I didn't let anybody down. He grabbed Rick Reynolds Forsaken and he wound him up and tagged me. I come in, he went to punch me, I blocked, man. I gave him the old Idaho. and Scott Spade was there, and I've seen him ask Rick, did he get you? And Rick's shaking his head, yeah, he got me. It's like, what's new? but so then we did the deal where we had the young guy, Corey. It was the, young guy, and Tommy Hagen's son.
Homie D.
He come running at us, and we throw the old Mexican arm drag on him.
Nice.
So we did more than what we said we were going to do. So, yeah.
Let's say you were going wide open again. If you had one more match, who would it be?
Definitely would have to be Scott Spade because Scott's been after me for a long time to let's have one match. You know, let's just so that we can say we had one.
Okay.
And he's been after me. So I really owe him a match if I ever could ever do a match, real match, you know, to where. So
I like that. Yeah, I like Scott. He's a good dude. Big fan of Scott. So, okay, I'm going to ask one here. So what are, like, you know, it doesn't matter your diagnosis with the doctor. We know you're going to fight this. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. You know, we know that God's got this, and that's the important part. But what are some of the things that you have on your personal bucket list that you would like to achieve?
I'll tell you, I really don't have a lot of things there. I mean, one thing is me and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You know, I've had to have some serious talks with him because I haven't lived my life perfect. And, you know, it's time's getting close. But anybody on any day should realize your time could be real close. Another minute. We're not promised nothing. So that's one thing to make sure I've got that straightened out first and foremost.
Yeah.
And then the next thing is to make sure my family knows how much I love them and I care about them. And then how much, if we're ever going to meet, see each other someday, we all better be right with God.
Yeah.
So that we can meet up again someday, you know?
Yeah.
And I want to make sure those bases are covered right there. But I think me and, we've talked about like taking a trip to the mountains.
Okay.
You know, just one. You know, I always like the mountains. My wife likes the beach, but I always like, you know, just Gatlinburg, somewhere close.
Yeah,
something like that. Big plans. You know, if the time would have allowed, would go out west. I've never really been out west. I've been to California and all that when the Marine Corps, but I never really visited out west and like Montana and the Dakotas.
And
you know all the big mountains out there. You know, Colorado. I never got to really do that. That was part of the plan of retiring is like, you know, go out west, you know, go to Florida, go to Gatlinburg, and then swap it out and go out west and just visit different places out there.
But,
and I've said this before, you can make plans, but it isn't always your plan that happens.
Sure.
God's got his plan. And I'm going to tell you, he's the ultimate booker, and I'll go with his plan.
Yeah.
He is the booker, ain't he?
Okay. Yeah, definitely. Well, I got two more I want to talk about, and I might get a little emotional on this one, so I apologize. But, you know, I've gained a close personal friend doing this podcast, you know, that I looked up to a lot as a wrestler, and I was always a fan of his work, and now we're 155 episodes in, 156 episodes in with one of the guys that I consider to be one of my favorite wrestlers. And, you know, Wolfie knows this. He knows how much I enjoy doing this and working with him. But I would say if there's been any other main gain from this, I would say it would be the friendship with you, Ben. I, you know, you can ask Wolfie. I talk about you all the time. And I mean, I'm always, you know, talking to you, talking about with you, with my brother Jared, with my wife. I mean, you know, you're always talked about. I'm sure your ears are burning, but I thank God, and I think that I've gained you as a good, close, personal friend, Ben. I've reached a point in my life to where, you know, you don't make as many friends, right? You tend to kind of stick with your clique, you know, and that's understandable. But I want to thank you for that and becoming a friend with you, because it's meant the world to me, and I can't, you know, I can't thank you enough for that, brother. You know, this question I'm about to ask you is a heavy one, especially with, you know, the battle you're fighting right now. But I think it's something that I want to hear your answer on. So if you were to have a magical pause button or a rewind button on your life, what would you choose?
And we just asked Steve that same question.
Yeah, I know.
Right now, I would pause everything.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, going forward, it's going to be a tough battle going ahead.
Yeah.
As far as the rewind, it, you know, there's things you could always do better and all, but life is what it was. You know, I lived it, I done it, I can't change it. There's things that I'm not proud of that I would probably go back and change if I knew, hey, you better go back and straighten this out. But no, I can't change anything. And so, so to think about to rewind it, you know, then everything, my whole world could be changed to a different thing, and like my kids and my wife, and it could all be different. So I don't think I'd want to rewind.
Okay. Pause button. Slow it down a little bit. I like it.
Yes. Well, wish I could have paused it a few weeks ago.
Sure. Yeah.
But Jimmy, I want to say this. It's been great getting to know you, and you've become a great friend. And, you know, I love you. You're another brother to me. This has been fun because I was totally out of wrestling. Yeah, and I didn't want to talk about wrestling. People could have called me before and said, you don't do a podcast. I said, I don't want to talk about it. I don't want nothing to do with it. I'm just totally out. And then everybody's like, hey, you got to listen to this. Give me back in the pro wrestling. You know, and Shane calls and says, hey, you know, get you on with Jimmy, you know, did this podcast. And the first thing made me real nervous about talking, you know, because I know I don't sound real educated and educated, but, you know, I was nervous about just the way I sound, and you know, just, I don't know, I didn't know if I could handle it, but we've done it, and like, I'm like, I look at it like this, at this point in the game, what does it matter? You know, I'll go ahead and talk and do what I can do, because, you know, you don't know how much longer you got to do it.
Right.
So, but no, you've brought wrestling, you and Wolfie, and the whole podcast, this whole thing here, the stories and the guys that you get on there that I didn't really even think about. And I listen to their story, and I'm going, wow, I was around about the same time, but we never got to, you know, hang out or anything.
Yeah, so I know.
That makes it really fun.
It does.
It's really fun.
I'm glad you feel that way, because
I enjoy wrestling again because we're talking about the old wrestling. I care less about the new wrestling.
Ditto. Yeah. Ditto. Yeah. Well, speaking of some old wrestling, and thank you for saying that, Ben, you know, you've said that before and it means as much every time you say it. So I greatly appreciate that. But my final question I have for you and want to conversate about is this one. I recently saw a video on good friend of the show, Brian Turner's VHS Rehab. Highly recommended. If you haven't checked it out, go check it out today. There's an awesome video of you and Boogie wrestling in at Kroll's cookout. Kroll and TJ had a cookout.
Yeah, I've seen that.
And yes. and dude, you are my new favorite Ben Jordan is Trailer Trash Ben Jordan, by the way.
Yes,
the one with the blonde hair and the dark roots and
and that was the look we were going for. We didn't want when we first, you know, did the bleach blonde, it's like, okay, we gotta let the roots grow out to where it really looks trashy. And we had to, of course, like the rock and roll RPMs, they had the dark goatees.
Yeah.
And I wanted to go for that look, you know.
I love that.
And it's kinda like if you were around in the '70s. Not sure, Wolfie, you had to do the math on that. But anyway, when I was going to wrestling in the 70s at the fairgrounds, you know, the wrestlers, and now I know, there wasn't that much money, so they would get their hair bleached, but it'd be a long time before they could go in and touch it up.
And get it so touched,
Especially the heels, you know, they'd have the big, you know, streak down the middle and just look cheap, and they didn't look clean. And I'm like, yeah, that's a mean wrestler right there. That's a bad guy.
The nasty villain with the nasty blonde hair. I love it. Yeah. But no, I mean, just the idea that video was done, because it's a good match. I mean, you and Boogie could work with your eyes closed. And
he was telling me, trying to coax me into the ring with the beer in the middle of the ring. That
yeah.
was great.
Yeah.
Was like, yeah. So that was great. I was trying to watch it again, but I get so busy right now. This time, everybody wants to talk, which is great. But it's like, okay, I need time for this. So I haven't watched the match. Does it show the part where I ride the bicycle?
Yes.
I've seen that.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good one. Again, just not to change the story, but I was mowing my mom's grass just the other day, 2 days ago, and I got a phone call, and this guy's like, "Hey, you know who this is?" And I'm like, "Well, no, it didn't tell me who it is. Tell me who you are." He's like, "You know who I am. You know who I am." He said, "You talked about wrestling the Kentucky guys. Had y'all done it?" He said, "But you and Steve never mentioned our names and everything." And I said, "Well, it's probably because I couldn't remember it." And kept on find out that it was somebody I used to love working with up in Kentucky. He was young at the time and coming up and full of fire and vinegar, you know. And but his name is J.D. Thunder.
J.D. Thunder, yeah.
And I think the last time I worked up in Kentucky, and we was working for, we worked against Handsome Jimmy and J.D. Thunder.
And you all worked him and Randall Shane quite a bit, too, because we talked about that a little bit with Steve.
Randall Shane, The names escaped me. And, you know, because of the many years, and you don't see people. And the promoter up there, I was trying to think of his name, because I was like, I think it works to do like a
Terry England or Dale Mann.
It was Terry England. Dale Mann's the first promoter I ever worked for in Kentucky. But Terry England, I swear, if we went up there for a reunion, he'd probably charge every one of us to get in.
Yeah, he would. Yeah.
I believe
Terry England. Yeah. And then the other guy that was with him was Chad, and I can't remember Chad's last name. Really good guy. But he was always with Terry running the shows up there.
I know who you're talking about. I can't think of his last name.
Yeah. But I hate it because I didn't want to leave anybody out every time I talk. Like now, I can't say everybody. I want to mention everybody's name, but I can't. But all my, I just wanted my Kentucky brothers to know we love them. You know, Gator McAllister, he's one of them.
And, yeah. Old Terry's up here. Oh, Terry Adonis.
Terry, oh man, he was like my third match ever. And, of course, you know, he'd do the little tease and, like, wait till I get in the ring with you. I'm like, oh, okay. but he treated me great.
Yep.
Sure did. We had a good
That's
night.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Ben. Love you, buddy.
Yeah, absolutely, Ben.
I wanted to throw that Kentucky love in there because I didn't want those guys still left out.
Oh, no. Yeah. Please do.
You know. Yeah, man. Hey, I just want to say, man, I, you know, me and Jimmy talked about this, and it's like, I didn't know, and I don't know how you were going to receive the fact of, hey, let's get Ben on here with the news, you know, with the news or whatever, because we didn't want it to be like, oh, let's use this as a gimmick.
Right.
It's not a fucking gimmick, bro.
No.
I fucking love you. I think you know that from that we talk every day now, and I still want to talk to you every day, man. So I don't know.
We can do it.
It was just a weird thing of man, I hope nobody thinks this is awkward or we're trying to do this for any other reason than I wanted your voice to be heard on. And I, and once you and your wife put out the thing on Facebook, what is it, the Ben Jordan journey, I think y'all put out? Yeah. So when I really saw that, I was like, okay, I'm good with this, man, because he's ready to get it out there. Because at first, you know, you told us, don't tell nobody. And I did.
Well, I didn't want to get swamped because I knew everybody would be calling questioning
right,
their
mind. Right.
Let's let it sink in. Let me be with my family. Let you know. And then I knew once people started finding out, they'd start calling and texting and all. And,
right.
And you know, some people have the deal of like, they've got the idea of like, well, you didn't talk to me when I was healthy. Why you want to talk to me now? Because I'm dying.
Yeah.
I'm not like that. If I get to talk to anybody I haven't talked to in years, to me, if I get that opportunity, I'm going to take it. It's great.
Yeah. And you also know the wrestling business is weird, man. We've met so many people, been around so many people, had great times with people, but then we lose contact.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, you don't have contact anymore, you know? It's a weird business, man. It's a weird business, but we all have, we share that brotherhood, and I love you, Ben Jordan.
I love you, Wolfie D.
Yeah.
You too, Jimmy.
I love you too, buddy.
It's been fun. You know, like I said, I wish I could sit here and just name everybody in the business because I love them all. And I know everybody likes to hear the name on the podcast. But it's too many to name, you know, and there's too many good ones. And if you say one, then you leave another one off.
Right.
Yeah, I'll get you one right now. The other day, Kroll called me.
Yeah.
And I love that call because me and him don't talk a lot, but we've always had that bond. And then there's hundreds of them that, you know, if they call tomorrow, fine, I'll talk, you know, just to try to remember and mention everybody's name. If you say one, you're going to hurt somebody else's feeling because you didn't say theirs.
Well, I just hope everybody listening knows that Ben loves you, Wolfie loves you, Jimmy loves you, and we did this for a good reason, not for numbers, man.
If they're worried about that, they're worried about the wrong thing, bro.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
We're with you, Ben.
If you don't get nothing out of it, if I can't spread anything else, but, you know, like I said, you have the love of Jesus Christ first. You know, you got that. And if this podcast could give anybody a sense of hope, you know, when you get the worst news you can ever get, don't think all hope is lost.
Right.
Because, you know, I'm going to tell you, if it isn't his plan for me to be here on this earth, well, you know where the next place I'm going to be? I'm going to be there.
With him.
So, you know, and I've always known you're not really supposed to live for this world, which we all do, but you're supposed to be living for the next world. Unfortunately, I haven't spent my life living like I wanted to get to that world. So, you know.
Well.
Wow.
Love you, buddy. Golly.
I love you guys. And I'm glad we've done this because, you know.
Thank you.
Like I said, one thing, it's just great talking to y'all, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. It is. I mean, that's the other thing. It's just a good conversation, you know. And we thank you so much for that, brother. Really, just we're immensely blessed.
I'm jealous of you, Ben. I'm jealous of you for being a better man than I think that I am. Honestly.
Well, hopefully you won't ever have to prove it. Hopefully you don't ever get that news. But if you do, maybe if you can look back and say, well, dadgummit, Ben hung in there, and he wasn't all down about it. You know, and I can get down about it if I'm going to sit and just dwell. But there's nothing I can do. I'm going to tell you, I really hope nobody gets that news, but there's going to be people that get the same news. And I hope, like I said, just turn your eyes, you know, up to the sky, you know, because that's what you got.
That's the best advice. Golly.
Love you, Ben. Love you. I'm not even doing a segue after this. Man.
We're good. Yeah.
We'll be back.
Love you, buddy.
I love y'all.
We'll talk to you soon, Ben. Okay? Thank you, Ben.
Okay. Call me anytime.
All right. Sounds good, brother. DJ, hit the music. We'll be right back. right, we are back with Ask Wolfie D Anything, and man, oh man, Ben, wow, what a great story that guy has, man.
Yeah, seriously, man. I mean, it's going to be a battle, man. Like I just keep saying, just everybody let Ben know how much you care about him and keep doing what it is you do, and hopefully he can pull through this, man.
Oh, yeah. He's got so much faith and hope, and just honestly, he's really just chock full of it. And
he's very inspirational, I'll tell you that. Yeah. It just makes me, like I said at the beginning, it makes me, you know, I'm sitting here, you know, got a little cold or COVID or whatever you want to call it, and, you know, I'm complaining about that.
Well, I mean, you know, we all get perspective on things, man, but, you know, each of us have a battle of our own, and, you know, but I think if anything, if you gain somewhat of a positive mental attitude like Ben has, you know, you can pretty much beat anything as long as you're thinking in the right frame.
It's definitely possible, man. It's definitely possible.
Yeah.
That's what we're hoping for.
Amen. And we love Ben, and we, you know, like Wolfie said, just keep your prayers for Ben. We appreciate him, and I know he does too. So we've got some questions here, as always, during Ask Wolfie. And so the very first one is from Fraction Jackson 139 on YouTube. And he says this: what are some of the most important unwritten rules of wrestling? And he gave some options here. He says, you know, he knows wipe your feet before getting in the ring. You know, shake hands with everyone, you know, keep the locker room clean, you know, that kind of thing. What are some to you that are the most important?
Well, I'll tell you what, that wiping on the ring, I never caught on to that one, I'll be honest with you.
Really?
Yeah, I never really caught on to that one until later. And maybe it wasn't a conscious thing either, but I can tell you that I didn't do it on purpose. But if I did it. And then shaking hands, of course, I was taught that early on.
Right.
Now, I will say, you know, we make fun of it now. You know, the little limp handshake that a lot of guys, especially on the independent circuit back in the you know, 90s and all that. And that was supposed to be some kind of code or something.
Right.
Yeah. You know, as I got older into the business, I realized it was almost a rib. I don't know why they were doing it. So that became a non thing for me anyway. And how most people fist bump or hug or, you know, that now.
Right. Right.
Unwritten rules. So I guess another unwritten rule with the vets and, you know, where they sit in the locker room or whatever. Some guys had in Louisville had their own room, of course. And yeah, everybody honored and respected that. But then there was two open areas where kind of everybody else would go. And I mean, I chose that pretty much anyway. I didn't have the clout to go get my own room. I think later on I think I did move into one of them, but it had to be because I think like Danny Davis moved out, you know what I'm saying?
Made room. Yeah.
Yeah, you had to have you had a vacancy and somebody with a little seniority could go get it. You know, Lawler had his own room in Memphis, and you know, yeah, it comes with seniority. But yeah, you just kind of respected that some places. And if you had your own room like that and it was a nice building, you tend to not make a mess. I mean, but then there's places you go and it's almost like, what the fuck, you know, and throw your tape on the ground, you know.
It's a wreck already. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, paying that much attention to that rule. I was just trying to think if there was any other stuff like that. But not wearing not being a mark for the belt, well, that's out the fucking window, I can tell you that. That used to be a thing where, you know, people would ask us, where's your belt? Well, we don't even keep them, you know?
Right.
For one, they didn't trust us. other people had done stuff with their belts before. And,
right.
And there's a story out there about somebody else we know that did something with their belt. But, yeah. And it also just made your fucking bag heavy.
Right. I mean,
really, that was the thing. Just makes your bag heavier. And I remember Colorado Kid getting ribbed really bad because he was one of the first ones that was a really, you know, proud to have that son of a bitch. And a lot of the guys was hard on him, man. But, you know, now. Hey, you win a belt, you take a picture of it, and you put it on fucking Facebook and let everybody know you're the XMLOP champion.
Exactly. Yeah. So, yeah. So a lot of the unwritten rules are basically thrown out the window these days.
I'd say it's a whole different locker room, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
This is a different breed. We used to say we were a different breed, but now they are a different breed. And
even further, yeah. Yeah, and that's not even talking about the new breed, right? No, I'm just kidding.
No.
Yeah.
The breed actually hasn't happened yet. Or what year did Christendom say they were from? Do you remember? I don't.
Like 2020, I don't either. Yeah, no, I don't either.
I wonder if it's fast.
Yeah. It's probably close, if not. Yeah. Yeah.
But you got to figure, 1980 whatever, they were probably somewhere around now.
Yeah, probably somewhere around now. They were going to have flying cars and people were going to be, you know.
People were going to be fucking morons.
Yeah, well, they got that part covered. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So, well, the next question is from Dreadnought99 on YouTube, and he asked this question. He says, what's the most brutal rib you were a part of or remember someone doing?
Oh, I mean, I was no part of it, but I've always heard stories of some that are like, I mean, everyone heard the story of, I think it was Kern that took a shit in Lawler's bag. That's pretty fucking heavy, man.
That is a heavy rib, man. That's
pretty fucking heavy.
Wow. Ballsy.
Yeah, man. Let me think of anything that I, probably anything that has to do with me, I probably can't tell you. But, I mean, I thought the funniest one, even though I didn't go through with it, really was, you know, getting Tommy to.
Yes, the creatine. Yes. That would have been brutal, but at least you had the heart to not let him go through with it. Because I'd say there were other times you were like, man, I should have let him do that.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's a brutal one. Yeah. Well, you know, that's just, I've heard the poop in the bag before. I've heard the poop in the crown before. I've heard the, you know, all kinds of nasty stuff. But, you know, shaving the eyebrows, man, that would be brutal, you know.
Yeah. Mm. Like that, yeah, that was Mr. Perk and so.
Yeah. But a lot of that was due to boredom, right? I mean, they're just, you know, basically.
Yeah, we didn't have cell phones to look at and video games to play. Well, we did eventually get video games. But
yeah, yeah.
Didn't take those to every town because every town didn't have a TV to hook it up to.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Well, the last question of this episode is the last rebel from YouTube, and he asked this one. He says, hearing you talk about your tag team ideas of Chris Champion on the Chris Hamrick show, do you regret not trying to take those ideas further, or was PG-13 always the main focus and it really wouldn't have happened?
PG-13 was just, it was a timing. And timing's everything in entertainment and you know, in the wrestling business, you know. It was at the perfect time, man. It just was. The book, the everything. And it was, you know, those other ones were, you know, decent ideas. I don't know that, you know, they'd have gotten that far. But PG-13 was just two right guys, right gimmick. Right place, man. You know,
we
worked well together and we did the gimmick well, and it just happened.
And the magic that y'all were together pretty much, you know, would have put any other kind of other idea as just like, well, that's a cool idea, but maybe, you know. Maybe not. Like
we probably wouldn't have gotten hired and done the things we did if we had came in as the Cyberpunks.
Right.
It was PG, and then, hey, let's do one of those Loser Leave Town mask gimmicks because we got these cool fucking suits that we want to use.
Right, right. Yeah, so. Let's use that. Well, you know, like the crash test dummies idea, I could easily see that working in WCW, though. Like, awesome. You know, they had the ding-dongs, you know. I could have seen that.
It's definitely not dumber than that.
No. And the cool thing is like, you would not have gotten the prestige from it, but it would have been a fun gimmick to do as a bump-in gimmick, you know. You would have made a lot of people look like $1 million, but...
Right.
But yeah.
I couldn't have called us that because that was popular then too.
Right. You would have had to have been something else. But anyway, I love that idea. I still, man, I think somebody should do that, but you know, whatever. But
hell, some of the clips I see on social media, some of these motherfuckers are crashed.
They are doing it.
Just that is a great point.
Yeah, that's a great point, actually. Yeah. Well, brother, that is all I got for today, my friend.
All righty. Well, it's been fun. It's been a different sort of episode for us because it was more serious than usual. But man, we love Ben.
Yeah. Amen.
Hope the best for him.
Definitely. And you know, sometimes you gotta laugh and cry a little bit. You know. Yeah. And, you know, that's
laughter works wonders.
Yeah. But I highly recommend anyone to go out and look up that Jerry Lynn match he was talking about, the Barry Horowitz match he was talking about, or the Sean Waltman Lightning Kid match he was talking about. Ben worked some great guys in Global and mm-hmm. they're great matches. And, you know, he was the light heavyweight champion for a reason, you know.
Right. So. Yep. Well, all right. Y'all tune into us next week, and hopefully my voice will be back.
And now a word from our sponsor.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Give Me Back My Pro Wrestling, the podcast that's based on the old school but can still help you find the good stuff from today. Jimmy Street and the plastic chic Jared are the undisputed tag team champions of the wrestling podcast world. From thought-provoking topics to superstar interviews to action figure expertise, this team does it all. And all they ask is, give me back my pro wrestling! Every other Thursday, wherever you listen to podcasts.
That's right. It's the talk of Middle Tennessee, the channel you love to hate and the channel you hate to love. It's Brian Turner from Brian Turner's VHS Rehab. And if you're looking for matches from Wolfie D to Jerry Lawler to Dusty Rhodes and the team that put a pimp before your eyes and a goatee between your thighs, Boudica and Athena, go to LostWrestling.com. See, I made it easy for you. Brian Turner's VHS Rehab. Booyah!
Hey everybody, Gene Jackson here, inviting you to check out the Retro Wrestling Review, where each week I'm joined by some great co-hosts who help me review classic episodes of USWA Championship Wrestling, and right now we are doing week-by-week reviews of 1993. But we don't just do reviews, sometimes we get a chance to interview some of the people who were there and lived it, plus do watch-alongs. It's a lot of fun, so check out new episodes that drop every Wednesday at WrestleCopia.com. And to find links to everything associated to the podcast, you can go to uswapodcast.com.
Hey, it's the Heat Miser Scotty Blaze. Now I'm inviting all of y'all to join me on my brand new podcast, Turning Up the Heat with the Heat Miser Scotty Blaze. What are you waiting for? Come on over and join me. I'll be covering all the events of the day, global, national, pop culture, movies, gaming, whatever sounds interesting. But I'll also be playing some awesome skating shuffle music from the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s. Anything that has a good beat, I'm going to be playing it. You can rest assured. Come on over, tuthradio.com. The podcast is on every major podcast platform. See you then.
Are you a pro wrestling fan? Well, stop by Captain's Corner, where you can get autographed photos, cards, magazines, and figures from all of your favorite wrestling superstars of the past, present, and future. You'll also be able to participate in live signings in the weeks and months to come. Make sure to stop by Captain's Corner on Facebook and give us a holler. Remember, cheers to the working man.
So that was another great episode. Hey, Wolfie, tell them where they can find you on social media.
Jimmy, they can find me in the club, bottle full of bub. I'm just kidding. They can find me on Facebook. My personal page is Warren Wolf, W-O-L-F-E. I'm on Instagram, at WarrenWolf13.
You can always find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, at LiveWolfieD. Here's the thing. Wolfie always has offers for his autographed photos. He has a selection of some awesome photos from throughout his career that he will autograph and personalize any way that you want him to. Just contact him either directly at his personal Facebook page or through any one of our other pages, and we'll make sure you get in contact directly with Wolfie. Get those photos, right, Wolfie?
Yeah, I've got some good stuff on there, you know, to help with the podcast.
Folks, if you can't get out to a show to meet Wolfie D, there's nothing like that, especially for the fans of PG-13 and Wolfie D. And before we go, you can always find me, your host, Jimmy Street, at James Rock Street on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube.
And hey, Jimmy, before we go real quick, I just want to add in there, from the bottom of my heart, I really appreciate, first of all, the work you've done for this podcast. You have worked your butt off. Secondly, the people that are liking the page. Beyond that, even more, is the people that are listening, and we really appreciate that.
Yeah, and remember, guys, the podcast drops a new episode every Monday at noon, and our past episodes are streaming now on demand on all major podcast formats. Thanks again.
I got a cap for you, don't.
He got a cap for you, don't.
I got a cap for you, don't.
He got a cap for you, don't.
For you, don't. And here we go. The original white boy that came out sagging, not bragging. Don't be hating, cause I'm spitting the truth. Still livin' in color. Plum rush your mother. Utilize a hubcap. I'm like any other. Back in the day, I was N-O-D. And I was P to the G, plus the 1 and the 3. In case you forgot, they call me Wolfie D. Been cloned and copied so many times. Tired of suckers taking credit for what is mine. You know who you are without me name dropping. Wrestling's first white boy coming out hip hop. Been doing it like this since 92. Laid low for a while when you thought I was through. Listen real close to these rhymes that I've injected. This shit's so sick it makes your ears get infected. Mad skills, no faking, there is no one great. Cause I'm bringing more folks than Obi-Wan or Vader. Not here to play games, so you better beware. You don't like me, so what?
I really don't care.
Like time I keep ticking and I can't be stopped. You sucker, step to the side unless you wanna get dropped. When I finish, I'll straight knock you out. Please allow me to tell you what it's all about. I'm gonna wind it up, then I'm driving it home. It's Wolfie D, baby. Huh? I got a cap for your dome.
You got a cap for your dome. You got a cap for your dome. You got a cap for your dome.
This has been a James Rock Street production.